Trump.
Don't swear. Excessive use of profanity is the sign of an underdeveloped
frontal... EPA budget cuts closed my office today.
Fuck Trump!
Yeah. 14 of us were laid off. 14.
I'm sorry.
Job creative my pass.
What are you gonna do?
I don't know. I have no idea. I should have seen this coming, but... Wow.
Don't lie down on the floor like that. It makes you look defeated.
I feel defeated. What have we come to?
I don't know. I didn't know how we got here. I mean, ignorance, misogyny, and I think Russian intervention.
What am I gonna do?
I hear they're looking for wall builders a little south here.
You suck.
You could join the military. I hear we're starting wars with, like, everybody.
What happened to our country?
I don't know.
No, really.
I don't know. It's rotten.
Yeah. Do you know what that stupid wall would do to the environment around the Rio Grande?
Yes.
Do you know how devastating it would be for animal migration?
Yes.
And the flooding it would cause could wipe out both human and animal habitats.
Yep.
And cement production is a major cause of greenhouse gas emissions.
I know that. I'm a fucking scientist.
Well, why don't they know that?
I think they own the cement factory, so, you know.
Well, they're all short-sighted, self-serving assholes who are destroying our fucking planet.
Yeah.
God, I'm depressed.
I don't know anyone that isn't depressed, angry, or afraid right now.
Or all three.
Or all three.
You don't mind if I just lie here on your floor for a while, do you?
You should go out with me.
Are you hitting on me again, Ames?
Out tree planting, bozo.
Oh.
Go out tree planting. Or reforesting that ugly clear cut above evergreen.
What for?
So there'll be a forest there again.
No, really. What for? This whole planet's going to hell in a handbasket.
I don't believe in that.
You know what I mean.
Yeah.
So why bother? Why?
It's what I can do. I'm doing what I can do. Right here, right now. Mm-hmm. Think globally, act locally.
But I want to act globally. I'm a fucking climate scientist.
Just start where you are. Use what you have. Do what you can.
You tried to remind me of what it says on every bumper sticker on your fucking Prius.
They're great bumper stickers. I chose all 17 of them very carefully. Evolution fish has feet.
You're ridiculous.
No, I'm not. Lying on the floor, watching Netflix, and eating cookies isn't going to save the world.
I've started to doubt that anything can. I like my job.
I know. You're saving the planet.
Yeah. Yeah. Yeah.
You don't have to stop just because they lay you off.
No.
No. Resistance is never futile. Resistance is necessary. It's only when they make you think you've lost your power that you lose your power.
Those are more of your bumper stickers, I think.
My bumper stickers rock. Have a cookie.
You did it.
I did.
Thank you.
Have a tree.
Saving the planet. One tree at a time.
I'm a botanist. That's what I do.
You think it's gonna work?
Queer. Gonna make it work.
Okay. Okay.
stuff. Actually, with an ozone sonde, now that I come to think of it.
A what?
An ozone sonde. For measuring the ozone in the stratosphere. But they sent it up too high, and the balloon burst before they could get any readings. Well, I'll just have to launch another one and do it all again tomorrow. They should use an electrochemical concentration cell. Everyone uses ECC now, much more reliable. And they should send it up to 28K, not 30K. Must be thingies.
What is?
Thingies. FNGs. Effing new guys. That's what they're called, that first time wintering over.
How do you know all of this?
Lived outside Scott Station 3 seasons. You'd be surprised at what you pick up. Hello? What's this? Never saw anything so funny in my life.
What makes you laugh?
Look at those goggle eyes, like a picture of a goose drawn in the snow with a flip by a fledgling. Oh, what? What a handsome creature. Look at that crimson plumage. The question is, what is so attractive about these icy lands to humans? Oh, look! There's another one! Oh, it's like plucked petrol.
They smell funny.
Actually, they stink. Yuck, what have they been eating?
You're vocalizing as the morning chorus?
Oh my god, they're so cute! So pitiful with their bare skin and scrawny feet!
Are they still out there?
Yeah, wouldn't be anywhere else now, would they? Police, National Guards, US Army. We got more scared, huh?
Are they still shooting the water cannons?
Nah, they stopped 15 minutes ago.
What about the people? They should get inside before they get sick. I'll see if I have some blankets for them. I think Mary Yellow Eagle Sun was one of the ones at the front.
Are you taking stuff out for the soldiers too?
They're people, Jessie. They get cold and hungry too.
Even after what they did?
Winking, kicking. We're fighting this for them too. And just because they use violence against us doesn't mean that we
use it against them.
See? You know.
Do you think they're going to outlast us?
They just might. No jokes. I would kill for a real leader right now.
We're natives. We'll do it like our ancestors did. We got a fire.
Doesn't matter, because it's outside, isn't it? And even our ancestors had proper teepees. Where'd you get this thing from? It's so drafty. No joke. I need to have a word with your father when he gets back. He's going to teach you how to build a tent properly.
He started doing such short notice. Me and Dad, we didn't have enough time to get everything we needed for winter. We didn't think we'd be here this long.
Really? Why? Did you think we would have won by now?
Nah, just thought they would have forced us out or arrested us or something.
They tried, didn't they? You know Karen Mosh, no? No? You know your daughter, though. One you used to play with all the time in fourth grade. Well, her mother ended up arrested, got put in one of those dog kennels, you know? They kept her there, lots of people too, trying to shut us up, trying to scare us. They don't know nothing. Think that's going to scare us off our land? Nah, we are stubborn as all hell.
I don't know. We've got a lot of money in this pipeline, and money's what seems to win history. That's why our people lost.
Who told you our people lost, eh? We didn't lose. If we did, none of us would be here because we'd all be dead. But we are as stubborn as all hell, in it. They couldn't kill us off, so they stuck us on reservations and expected us to just die. And when that didn't work, they tried to kill our culture, taking our kids and putting them in those schools. And that didn't work. So now, since they can't take the land by force no more, now they're trying to kill the ground under us. What cock cookie? Don't they know they're only going to kill themselves? Can you eat money? Can you drink oil? Can you breathe those fumes?
No.
No. And when we try and tell them that, when we are just trying to stop them from killing the earth, what do? They attack us with dogs and guns and what's that called?
Pepper spray.
Pepper spray. That's it. They do all of that and now water cannons in the middle of winter. I mean, what are they thinking? Don't they get it? We are not just fighting this for us, you know.
I know.
And then they do all that. And now, if they get their pipeline in, then the whole thing gets polluted. The whole of Turtle Island. And then what? Who are they going to blame?
Us!
To whom? Who are you talking back to your auntie?
It's Han, auntie. I'm sorry.
That's my fault.
Hey, Grandma. You know about the black snake. Is it true?
That prophecy's been with our people for a long time now. No, I think it's true.
And the black snake, do you think our people can kill it?
You want to know if the prophecy told the outcome. If this pipeline really is the black snake from the prophecy.
It is though, isn't it? Everyone says so.
And everyone is right, huh? What do you think?
I think it's true.
Well, then it's true. Prophecies are like that, you know.
What if we do all of this and they still build it? What is the point to all of this?
It is not pointless, Jessie. Don't let anybody tell you anything different. What we've done here at Standing Rock, what we're going to do, it's connecting hearts. It's giving back the vision to all the people who've lost it. Not just our people, all people. And so what if they build the pipeline? If that happens, we don't give up. When have our people ever given up? And I think that we're living proof that there is always hope. If they build the pipeline, then we find a way to shut it down. And we fight them through whatever legal system crap they throw our way. And we don't stop fighting until they see the earth for for what it really is, a gift. It's not theirs, it's not ours. It belongs to everyone, and everyone has a responsibility for its well-being. And if it is sick, we find a way to cure it. Some people will say that we're liars, that we're heathens, or that we're
dumb savages.
Doesn't make it true, though, will it? Some people just have loud voices, eh? So just because one or two of them are yelling louder than the rest, it doesn't mean they can drown the savages. Sometimes a whisper is louder. And don't forget, there is more of us fighting to save our future than there is them trying to kill it for us. Remember that.
Where are you going?
And take some of this jerky to those soldiers. That one from earlier today.
The one that shoved you?
He was a bit thin. I think some meat will do him good.
He's just gonna throw it back anyway.
Yeah, that's true. He just might. But I'm not scared of that.
What are you scared of?
Of not doing the right thing because I'm scared? Of staying silent when I need to speak? Of being afraid to act in case I might fail? These are the things I'm scared of.
Do you want to know what I'm scared of? Snakes. Black ones.
Me too.
Wait. I'll help you. We'll do this together, okay?
Freedom, okay? That is beauty. Our ancients granted it to all living things before us.
Here we go.
Like you, I emerged unassumingly into something preconditioned.
Right.
I didn't know that at birth.
You've told me this a million times. Purity, freedom, beauty, all tainted. I get it.
Do you? About her birth, who our ancients granted life to. Our arrival.
Stop regurgitating your uncle's stories.
What about when people first learned to eat? Crawl, sit, stand, walk, talk. Did you hear that one? Now we just talk and talk and talk and talk.
And you're doing?
But I listen. Still learning, teaching, relearning, reteaching. As did our forefathers before us and theirs before them. I have adapted.
We are in the modern age now. You do realize that, eh?
But we have not changed much.
Really?
For some time.
Alright, why?
Since the day we knew about her, our care, our ways, our respect, our knowledge of her diluted, almost lost. But we have adapted nonetheless in this modern age, right?
Wait. What's lost?
You are lost.
I am. Stop talking.
Listen! I see now what Uncle talks about. Her and her children's awakening. The way she squirms, slinks, and jolts ever so subtly beneath our feet, then BOOM! Shaking us in her wake, rising and rising and rising as if to return us from where we came. Her children brush swiftly past our mere mortal souls, stealing the dead within us, thrusting us, our stuff, our things in mid-air like we're leaves off a breadfruit tree, drowning us in their unforgiving cover coats and tears. They torch us with their beams of anguish, engulfing us in our own fears, reminding us of their wrath, before leaving us to our uncertainties. Who am I to ease their pains, or mine, or yours? We are mere mortals,
and you say I'm lost.
In our lifetime, we have been sold his teachings about the new dawn rising we're supposedly meant to prepare for. And where is he now? Tell me that. I once believed he was here before her, but now I don't know anymore. Him, her, purity, freedom, beauty, everything is tainted, like Uncle says.
If it matters that much to you and your uncle, is there something we can do together?
He says, we have grown in a way where for some of us, our desires have differed widely.
What are you talking about? Because clearly it's not an action plan.
Yeah. I'm not so sure anymore.
Well, what if he also told me he believed he lived within her freedom once?
I don't know what that means. Maybe he lied to me. Now just lied to you.
Anyway, what if I told you that I'm already doing something to help her, him, whoever?
What? Like all living things will see the new dawn rising, that kind of something.
Yeah, okay, no. We'll see the new dawn. Tomorrow.
For how long will there be another tomorrow, though? Uncle says the land, its eyes and teeth, knows the truth.
Another busload of tourists come to see us in a dump.
Do you know what I heard the other day?
What?
One of them said.
What?
Ah, that we could carry off their young.
we're good, but we're not that good.
Oh, little bit, I'm so scared.
Trying to run away, but there was nowhere.
I know, there's like 3,000 of us here.
Oh, yeah, they're done as posts. Actually, I think a post is smarter. Fits my claws better. Do you think they're jealous?
Sure. We've got 3 times their assets, 10 times the Google power.
Seriously?
Seriously.
They're pathetic. Ah! Oh! Ooh. Oh! Sorry.
Oh, I think you've got the girl right in the eye.
Oh, it was an accident. It's a reflex. We all do it when we take off to fly. I think she's taking it personally. She's crying.
What if you have someone pooped on your head?
It was an accident. Don't tell me you don't make mistakes. DDT, milk chocolate, bracken nail. If you're messing up the ecosystem, the salmon would still be spawning there. You could bring your tourist bus to somewhere nicer than this city dump. Oh, seriously. Why is it still snowing? It's snowing everywhere. More snow than ever.
I love the snow.
Hope spring never comes. You're so dippy! I think everything's gonna be okay. What if spring never comes? No seedlings, no salmon.
They know, they know. They'll figure it out, you'll see. The fish will spawn. We'll get back to bracken now. We'll stop eating milk chocolate and rats.
No, I'll miss the rats.
Well, there was rats in Brackendale. You just didn't notice because the salmon was so good.
Salmon.
They'll save the ecosystem. They'll figure it out. They banned DDT and they saved our lives. They can do it again.
So, where are you from?
New Orleans.
Awesome! I went to Mardi Gras myself a few times back in the day.
Yeah, quite the party.
What made you move to Toronto, of all places?
You won't like my answer.
Come on.
Katrina?
Ah.
Yeah.
Maybe we should call it a night.
I didn't know what else to do.
I'm out of need to get more.
It's a support group for spouses of the Mars 19. You can go and talk to other spouses.
Oh, that's nice. That'll be nice.
Danny, don't.
How long have you known about this?
Told us my name.
So, a week. You had a week.
I didn't know how to, I'm sorry!
All engineers boarding flight 584 to Mars, please make your way to boarding gate 3.
Now, you will write, won't you?
Don't be like...
How am I supposed to be?
I love...
All engineers boarding flight 584 to Mars, please make your way to boarding gate 3.
Got it. Can you take another one just in case?
time I get undressed to look like a frog is leaping out of my underwear.
I feel sorry for them. Imagine being stuck in a park like this with what's left of your fellow sapiens for your entire life.
All right. I'm gone. If I don't come back, it's because I kissed a frog, it turned into a gentle, non-conforming, charming, and we alone.
Okay, I'll catch up.
It's way to be looking at your own past. Again, I can only imagine what it's like to stare at your future.
You know, whatever happened, I'm sure it was complicated. These things always are. So, I'm going to go out on a limb and say you tried your best. It was a mess. Some of you fucked up, some of you fought hard, and here we are. And isn't it wonderful? You evolved. All of the shit you went through made you evolve into me, a new species. Which, granted, isn't the greatest thing since sliced bread, but it's a step forward. I mean, think about it. Six extinctions. Not one, not two, six. Six times the Earth was nearly wiped clean of all life. So we should take some slack, is what I'm saying. No species is perfect. For all we know, the dinosaurs might have been assholes. It's not like they'd have the stone tablets to find out. So thank you. Yeah, thank you. Whatever you did wrong, you also did a lot of things right. And that's the story I want to remember. That's the story I want to tell. It's a story we need to celebrate. Us. Here, six extinctions later. I'm proud of being your kin, I really am. Hopefully the species that comes after me will be proud of being mine.
Frequently, though not always, deep breath. And begin.
It'll be alright. It'll be alright.
It's never gonna be alright.
I'll have a venti cappuccino double shot.
Come on!
I gotta get through my day, man!
Keep a moment to talk about the environment. Black Lives Matter? Islamophobia?
Donald Trump!
being here, you have started the move going to the device that is going to save the world, because you have supported Generation Zero with your presence, and they're doing very important work. And we have Victor Komorowski, who is the Wellington organiser, here to tell you what they are working on and how you can help. Thank you.
Sorry, I don't know if this is in my notes. Thanks so much for being here. As Elizabeth said, your contribution is going towards climate action, so thank you so much for that. Thanks also to my team, Annie, Charlie, and Julia from Generation Zero. And also thanks to Elizabeth and the team here for doing such a wonderful job. I was actually locked outside, so missed Elizabeth, but watched it from the window and listened, and you'd be surprised what you picked up. So, I missed the dance party, which I'm really gutted about. Anyway, so Generation Zero is a youth climate action organisation. For those who haven't heard of it, what we've been doing for the last 5 or 6 years is trying to connect people with politicians, amplify their voices, and get the politicians to do more on climate change. So that's what we're about. I'm here to speak about what actions you can take for climate change, and sort of beyond having a vegan diet and making better transport choices, it's actually quite hard to do personal action to reduce your carbon emissions. One thing that we're really lacking is the sort of coordinated support of, you know, political will and businesses and everyone basically working together to tackle climate change. And so that's why Generation Zero advocates on behalf of the community towards politicians to make that change. But there are obviously some things that you can do to help out with that. This is amazing climate action. This is, you know, connecting climate change with people's emotions is one of the very best things that we can do to deeply engage people and get them to start acting more for climate change. So thank you so much for this. So it's clear that we do need more action on climate change. It's coming, we're already feeling it now, and it's only going to get worse. But there is still time to avoid the worst of climate change if we act now. Clearly the politicians need to act a little bit more. As a nation, we promised under the Paris Agreement in 2015 to go zero carbon by about 2050. We promised that to the world. And in fact, our emissions have just been going up and up and up since then and before then, not going down. So that's awful. Generation Zero basically got so frustrated with this over the last 5 years. We were asking for the politicians to curb those emissions downwards, and nothing was done. So instead, we decided to take it upon our own hands. And we came up with what we call the Zero Carbon Act. The Zero Carbon Act is our proposal for a law that will get us down towards basically a carbon neutral or a neutral emissions country, and will allow us to do what we need to do for the world for climate change. So the Zero Carbon Act has three key elements. One is a long-term goal of getting Aotearoa down to zero carbon emissions by 2050. And it does that by staging it in little carbon budgets so that we know where we're going, we know what the roadmap is, we know what we have to do next year, and so on and so forth. So that's the first element. The second one is it forces the government and the whole of Parliament to create plans to do that, and also to create plans to adapt to the climate change that we're going to have. And lastly, it sets up an independent body which oversees that, reports on it, advises how to get there, and also makes what the politicians are doing transparent so that all the rest of us can see and can act where we need to. So that's the Zero Carbon Act. It basically makes it a legal requirement for us to do something about climate change, and we think it's the very first step that we need to take to start doing something meaningful. The good news is that the Zero Carbon Act is coming. The new government basically just announced that they want to see a Zero Carbon Act put on the table as a bill in the next 100 days, which is frightening because there's a lot of work to do. I guess the bad news is that the only way that that's going to work is if all of the political parties support it, because it's only going to work if everyone backs it and everyone is keen on it. So there's still a few MPs who aren't so keen on the Zero Carbon Act. And what we need to do in the next 100 days is get them to be supporting and endorsing the Zero Carbon Act so that when it finally does get passed, it sticks around and it does what it needs to do for the next 30 years. So in that, there's two things that you can do to help us out. We think this is the most important thing that you can do on behalf of the climate. The first thing, and it's super easy, is to basically sign a petition of support, give your individual support for this framework. So zerocarbon.nz, just on your phone, scroll down to the bottom and fill out your details, sign the petition. We've already got about 12,000, maybe 15,000 people who have endorsed that, but we need lots more. The second thing that you can do if you really want to get involved with this is to adopt an MP. Basically, target an MP who doesn't support the Zero Carbon Act, who hasn't sort of come out about the Zero Carbon Act yet. Meet up with them, talk to them, send them letters, do whatever you need to do to get them to publicly endorse the Zero Carbon Act. So that's what adopting an MP is about, and it's what we need to do in the next 100 days.
Is there a list available for each MP?
Yeah, totally. Yeah, there's some key ones that we need to target. But basically, we're trying to match you with the MP that you have some sort of connection to. So if there's anyone who's really keen to adopt an MP on behalf of the climate, then please get in touch with myself, the Generation Zero team. So that's basically, those are the key things that I think you can do. Obviously, there's a whole bunch of other actions you can be involved with. If you want to talk more about those specifically, just let me know. Any questions? Cool. So, yeah, two things. Sign the petition, zerocarbonact.nz, and get in touch with me if you want to adopt an MP. It should be fun. Age group, yeah, I said we're a youth climate action organisation. I'm kind of stretching the definition of youth, I guess. But basically anyone who's under 30 is considered youth and is good for the face of it. Basically, we don't really care so much about the youth thing. Anyone who wants to get involved with climate action is welcome. But, that's just our front image. High school students, definitely, we really want to see some more involved. Is there another question?
Is this somewhere you can get T-shirts from?
Oh yeah, I think they're about like $20 or something. They're online. Buy a t-shirt, again the proceeds go to us and help us do what we do. So I'll maybe send out an email or something with the links there so people can find those.
Facebook group.
Yeah, the Facebook event.
But it's generationzero.org, isn't it?
Right. Yes, that's correct.
Yep.
So, cool, thanks so much.
Should we give these guys a round of applause first?
Indigestion, she told herself, but she knew it wasn't. Knowing did no good, anyway. No more chemo, no more wonder drugs. There hadn't been a shipment of any drugs from overseas for years. These days, if you couldn't make it locally, you went without. She slung a bag over each shoulder and shuffled down the hallway, smiling at Mrs. Nerishan, who was tiredly walking back and forth, trying to quiet the baby. Behind the closed door of the second bedroom, she could hear raised voices. At least the authorities were only sending her one refugee family at a time these days, while they waited to be placed on the island for inland convoys. There had been times when she packed up to 18 people into her three-bedroom house. Melba greeted Marianne with a loud "Bah!" from her stall in the garage. The goat shifted impatiently as Marianne attached the carrier bags to her harness. "Dude," she said to the goat as they walked out to the street, "where's my driverless car?" Melba knew the answer to that one. "Bah!" Goats go where goats want to go. I don't think that counts as driverless. She could feel warmth in the wind from the east, bringing a swampy stench with it. And barely spring yet, Marianne thought. The mosquitoes would be hatching in the brackish marsh that covered the remains of Eastern Christchurch. She could hear high-pitched giggles as two little boys played in the water-filled pothole that spanned half the street, conducting a naval battle with tiny ships made from flat stems. Dot's granddaughter was hanging out washing in her front yard as Marianne passed, singing, "Rain still falls and grass still grows. Boys, he's girl, you know how it goes." Dot was leaning on the gate watching the kids, and Marianne stopped, yanking at Melba's rope when she tried to sample a roadside patch of cabbages. "Here," Dot said, "I saved some carrot tops. Did you hear about the latest reading? 10.73 metres. I always wanted a seaside property." She had a sense of fire at that joke. "Better get that bikini ready," Marianne countered, as she always did, and Dot cackled happily. The truth was there were no more beaches. There was no edge to the ocean anymore. It had gulped down half the city and vomited back a swamp of stinking mud and twisted wreckage. The last 10 years had been a frantic race against the tide to render down buildings and infrastructure to their constituent parts. Everything of possible use, including topsoil and trees, was removed by the locust army to be loaded onto the electric trucks trapping inland to the new cities. Fairly, Rampley, and even Sleepy Naseby had been transformed as the coastal refugees fled to the higher ground. Melba plodded around the corner, a carrot top dangling from her lips. Marianne let the goat pull her along, thinking back over the years. When was it? Was there one particular day? That day we finally realised things were never going to get better. There were those pictures on the news, back when they still had television broadcasts. That shaky video shot with a phone from the last plane to leave Kiribati. The clouds pressing against the chain-link fence at the airport. The wave of brown water churned up by the plane's wheels as it moved down the runway. The view of that young woman below, waist deep in the swirling water, holding up her baby over her head, mouth open and a silent "oh" as the plane lifted away. Was it then when the First Nation drowned? Or had they still thought something could be done? Was it the summer the farmers built piles of black and white carcasses, sending columns of stinking smoke rising up from the plains after the ship stopped coming and the dairy industry collapsed? Was it the winter that the flood waters covered South Dunedin, the Hutt Valley and Greymouth and never receded? Or that summer the meteorologists added new colours to their temperature maps and half of Australia went up in flames? Marianne shook her head. Maybe it was different than everyone who'd lived through the last 25 years. She tied Melba to a post outside the old supermarket, now filled with a combination farmers market and travelling garage sale. A hand-painted sign in the window of the old pharmacy offered books, drugs, and news for sale, gossip for free.
Hey Sam, she said. Got a fresh batch for you. Marianne, lovely to see you, Sam said, stepping outside to help her carry the bags inside. He laid the slim volumes on the counter, one hand absently scratching the lumpy melanoma on his left ear. Diphtheria, symptoms and treatment, he read slowly. What else have we got here? Goat husbandry? Compost toilet construction? Ross River virus? Radio operation and repair? Excellent. Riveting reading as always, Marianne. At least I achieved my life's ambition, she said. I am a published author, with sales in the hundreds. We should have a book launch party. Ah, yes, with wine and those little canapes on silver trays. Sam laughed. I really don't know where I'd get the smoked salmon and crackers. He took out a small notepad and added up some figures. Well, what you brought me today, here's what you have to spend. What can I get for you? She was looking out the window at the hills. Something from the back. I need 20 milligrams of morphine, Sam. Oh, my dear, he said. So soon? She avoided his eyes. Not yet, but I'd like to be ready. I don't know how much longer I'll be mobile. He looked at her for a moment longer, then turned and unlocked the door behind the counter. He returned with a small plastic container. Send word when it's time, he said, coming with her to the door. I'll come around. I will, she promised. I put some books aside for you. Outside, Melba had finished the carrot tops and was chewing on her lead rope, a thoughtful expression on her face. Come on, you silly goat, Marianne said. Let's go to the park and you can have grass for lunch. Melba said agreeably. Marianne looked up at the green hills as they walked. Rain still falls and grass still grows, she thought. Maybe I've not had that one particular day yet.
We wrote everything down in record books, but the numbers didn't look like much because we stopped feeling like we were the ones who counted. When the floodwaters rose up, we sank back down to the bush with the weka and the power planter snails and the katapo clinging to waterlogged webs and hukitua paddling, holding up their heads.
Spent further time as a house, or classroom, or a bridge, or pier,
All further time would be spent floating on the sea or river, or sucked into a swamp, or stopping a bank, or sprawled on a beach, bleaching among sand, stones, and sun. The train went on up the track out of sight, around one of the hills of burnt timber, and further west on the upper reaches of the place of the monstrous town was still marked ominously on the sky, a brooding gloom in sunshine, a lurid glare under the stars. I said his heaven would be only half alive, and he said mine would be drunk. I said I should fall asleep in his, and he said he could not breathe in mine. A ray peers into the rim of your eye. Why is our art so introverted? It doesn't mean a thing to the seagull or sun. The clouds don't understand a word. Their language is silence. His mouth opens. From inside him comes a slow stream, without breath, without interruption. It flows up through his body and out upon me, washing the cliffs and shores of the island. It runs northward and southward to the ends of the earth. Soft and cold, dark and unending, it beats against my eyelids, against the skin on my face. And if several people talk at once, an overlapping howling noise begins. Echoes generate echoes, our apparitions, the part of us which appears, are so momentary compared with the other, the unseen part of us, which spreads wide. The unseen might survive, be recovered somehow, attached to this person or that, or even haunting certain places after death. Perhaps. Perhaps the tree, after a lifetime of fruiting, has, after its first death, a further fruiting at the hands of a master. This does not mean that the man is the master of the tree. He is master only of the skills that bring forward what was already waiting in the womb of the tree. The new things born there console or constellate, they measure space, they keep time. But who wrote this story? And before writing, who told it to us that we tell it over and over? With what ineffable pleasure have I not gazed, and gazed again, losing my breath through my eyes, my very soul diffused itself in the sea. You are of me, and I of you. I cannot tell where you leave off and I begin.
Saving the planet, one tree at a time. So thank you very much for the invitation.